Okay, here, look. John Halligan has arrived now as well.
Richard Whitebard, John Halligan and Claire Daly to share 30 minutes.
Okay, look. Minister, obviously, we all welcome anything that will facilitate the further expansion, improvement or development of our public transport infrastructure, or anything that will facilitate greater investment in that infrastructure. Now, there's a few different aspects to this bill, and the first one in relation to the bus rapid transit, the BRT system, which, as I understand it, the legislation is designed to facilitate the NTA to make decisions in relation to the development of the BRT, the bus rapid transit system, for anybody who's watching this, we shouldn't use jargon too much, the bus rapid transit system seems, on the face of it, a good thing. It is a good thing, which is a sort of super bus corridor, really, to three identified routes being proposed: Swords to the airport, Blanchardstown to UCD, and Clongriffin to Tallaght. And all of those are important routes with which you know, are certainly about facilitating
commuters.
Indeed, it's not. You're so right. You're so right, Minister. It's about it's citizens. You're absolutely right. So you know, they seem like a very good idea, Minister, and I'd be in favour of them. But what I will say is, my fear, and I think it was touched on by Deputy Ellis there, my fear is that against a background of consistent reductions in the public subsidy, in the form of the public service payments, if you like, to Dublin Bus, which have dropped from 85 million in 2008 every single year, including every year under your government, now down to 60 million, a 25 million loss in the Exchequer money going into Dublin Bus, that what will happen, and I think what is happening, is we get a trade-off between these super bus routes, which we need and which are a good thing, and the public service obligation to provide unviable, commercially unviable routes to the citizens. And here, indeed, the distinction, if you like, between consumers and citizens is actually quite an important one, because with revenues going into Dublin Bus from the Exchequer being reduced, the temptation, indeed, I would say, the pressure that is now tangibly evident within Dublin Bus to see passengers as purely consumers that they can get money off is now putting pressure on them to cut routes which they consider not to be profitable or financially viable. That shouldn't be a trade-off, but it is becoming a trade-off. And sadly, my constituency is one where it is being felt particularly acutely. And I think I engaged with you, or certainly one of the ministers from your department, before the summer recess, about what can only be described as the savaging of the public service routes, whole routes, or the public service element of routes that might be busy routes, but aren't considered in certain parts of those routes to be particularly profitable. So we have plans to either change or cut altogether the 7 route, the 111 route, the 8 route, the 59 route, the 45A route, and the 63 route. All of those changes or out-and-out cuts are going to hit basically working class communities where there's a particularly high number of the elderly, of users, it might be young people and so on, which aren't the big consumer routes. Or in the case of the 7, which is a big commuter route, the part of that route which is, I suspect Dublin Bus feel, isn't terribly financially useful to them, which goes through Sallynoggin, where it's gone through that area for, you know, as long as I can remember, it's going to be taken out of Sallynoggin, dealing a very significant blow to Sallynoggin, right? Similarly, Killiney Village losing its bus altogether, Loughlinstown Park, another a very disadvantaged working class area, going to see the frequency of the buses going into that area cut in order to facilitate, if you like, the super commuter route from Cherrywood, which is considered to be a big transport hub, and so on and so forth. I won't go through the full list. But this is happening, and indeed, it is no coincidence that many of those routes I've just mentioned are also routes that are part of the 10% outsourcing, privatisation that your government is pushing through the plan to privatise 10% of the orbital routes. These are not coincidences, right? They're not coincidences. That these routes are being cut, slashed, and they're also the ones earmarked for privatisation, and they're being replaced with the super commuter routes. Now, don't get me wrong, Minister, I want the super commuter routes, but they should be additional to the routes that serve communities, villages, areas where there's a high proportion of the elderly or whatever. But that's not what's happening. And the reason it's not what's happening is because you have slashed the subsidy to Dublin Bus, which was already one of the lowest anywhere in Europe. Right? So this is the classic, it's the classic mechanism for the privatisation of a service that you're engaging in. And I know you're going to deny it and say, no, we're not, it's only a bit of privatisation and so on and so forth, but it is absolutely clear what is happening. And bus routes, which communities have depended on for decades and decades, are going to be lost in order to facilitate the privatisation agenda, or essentially pushing Dublin Bus away from the public service model into essentially a commercial for-profit model. So for that reason, I am very worried about it. And I think this BRT will end up accelerating that pressure, even though in and of itself, it is, of course, a good thing. I'll move on in the time available to me, which is what I've got, 2 minutes, Chair, is it? 2 minutes, to the issues to do with the taxis. Now, there's some of the regulations, the changes and so on, which seem to be reasonably positive. Others, I think taxi drivers will have concerns about. Ones that are positive, I think the section, I think it's 2A, that essentially will bring dispatch operators working off apps, isn't it? As I understand it, where we're talking about Halo and what's that new one called? I can't remember any, but the app operators, let's call them that, that they should be brought under the regulation of the NTA. That seems like a good thing, because in fact, some of these operators could very seriously undermine the existing taxi drivers, in fact are doing so. So to bring them at least under some sort of regulatory framework, I think is a positive move. However, there are other aspects which are a bit more worrying. There, in section 2H, I think you talk about where the licensing authority decides not to grant or revoke or suspend a license, that there will be no appeals. Now, I don't think there should be any process where any decision could be made that could affect the livelihood of taxi drivers where there's no appeals. There should always be an appeals process. So I think that needs to be looked at. And more generally, I have raised with you before, on behalf of the taxi drivers, the fact that there is a serious problem. We saw it most recently around the decision to change the fare structure, which also meant the recalibration of meters and so on, a cost for taxi drivers, where the representatives of the taxi drivers say that the Taxi Advisory Committee did not properly consult with them at all. And decisions were imposed by the NTA without a proper process of consultation. These are the sort of things that should be addressed in this bill, where there is real consultation and not, if you like, high-handed imposition of decisions from above in a way that can potentially be detrimental to the livelihoods of those workers. Very final point, Ciarán Cóirle. No, in fact, I haven't got time, but
Okay. Is that agreed?
I just get this right here. Yeah. Yes, just on the issue of the declaration. Okay. Now, I mean, it's not highly objectionable in and of itself, but it seems somewhat tokenistic, right? And what the taxi drivers are saying on the area of, you know, proper regulation of the industry is the problem is enforcement. That there are not enough people working for the NTA actually going around and doing the checks to actually catch the rogue drivers, the people who are not compliant in a whole series of ways, right? And this is of deep concern to, if you like, the bona fide taxi driver. So rather than tokenistic or decorative changes, and the declaration to me looks a bit like that, because really it's just saying, I'm undertaking to do things that I have to do legally anyway, right? That what we should actually be doing is put the resources in terms of enforcement. And a simple proposal that was made to me by some of the taxi drivers is there should be an emergency number for taxi drivers. If they suspect somebody is not compliant in some way or another, they should simply be able to ring an emergency number where they can call up the enforcement people and say, there's somebody who I've spotted who looks as if they're not compliant in one way or another. And there would be people around them. Those sort of simple practical measures, which do involve a little bit more resources, would be better than decorative measures that won't really make any difference. No.